The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus and his disciples returned once more to Jerusalem. As he was walking in the temple area, the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders approached him and said to him, "By what authority are you doing these things? Or who gave you this authority to do them?" Jesus said to them, "I shall ask you one question. Answer me, and I will tell you by what authority I do these things. Was John's baptism of heavenly or of human origin? Answer me." They discussed this among themselves and said, "If we say of heavenly origin, he will say, 'Then why did you not believe him?' But shall we say of human origin?" They feared the crowd, for they all thought John really was a prophet. So they said to Jesus in reply, "We do not know." Then Jesus said to them, "Neither shall I tell you by what authority I do these things." The Gospel of the Lord. Yeah, it's a teasing little gospel passage that we have in front of us today, but the back and forth is offered with a heightened sense of awareness, at least on our part, that there's a lot at stake here. It's not simply, you know, like a tennis match and, okay, well, you know, Jesus has returned the volley and, okay, you know, everything seems to be good. He's winning. He's coming up trumps in the game here. But no, it's a challenge. It's a challenging passage because there's much more going on just below the surface here. As we see this question of authority and knowing, of course, we're moving to that part of toward the end of Mark's gospel, where we see this confrontation coming to a head. But we see we know that authority has been a major theme of Mark's gospel to this point, and we know because we have witnessed the baptism of Jesus that his authority comes as in fact being the Messiah, the King of God, God's anointed King, and so he's the rightful King of the Jews. And this is, it's not always well accepted by the chief priests, by the temple authorities, but we think back to David, who first had that thought to build the temple, right? David's the king, he's not the high priest, he's the king, and his son Solomon, who builds the temple, he's the king, right? So it's the king who has authority over the temple, no matter what the chief priests want to say about it. And Jesus throws this rejoinder back to them about John the Baptist, because it's in the baptism of John the Baptist that Jesus is anointed as king. So if they were to have realized what was going on in the baptism of John, then they would be able to say that Jesus, in fact, does have rightful authority over the temple, as much as they'd perhaps prefer it not to be. But they find themselves stuck in this very difficult spot. And then we find out from that they really have no concern at all for the truth. And so they're asking this question, right? We're going to pursue the truth. We're going to persevere in the truth. We're going to ask him what the truth is. We're going to make him stand on the truth, and one way or another we'll be able to figure it out. But of course they don't really care in the end. You know, you just kind of push them a little bit and they don't really care. They want to figure out how to save political face, right? They want to remain in charge. They don't enjoy the fact that this guy is walking around in their space, teaching their people, turning over their tables, right? All the rest. He's upsetting things. So this is a big challenge, I think, there. But then I think there's a bigger challenge for us on the other side of that, because we do, in fact, realize that Jesus is the King of the Jews. Jesus is the rightful king. And so he does have authority. And then, of course, we've just celebrated Easter, the Easter season, Pentecost, and the rest. So we know already Jesus' ascension marks him out not only as the one having all power and authority, right? Definitively all power and authority. But he is now ruling over the entire world. And he rules chiefly through his faithful followers who are called to be members of his body. We're members of his body. He's breathing his spirit into us so that we can carry forward his work that will, yield the fruit of the kingdom, right? In our personal lives, we ought to expect to see the fruit of the Holy Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, generosity, faithfulness, and self-control. We ought to see that in our personal lives. But in our corporate and communal lives, we ought to see a growing towards the kingdom of God, God's kingdom of holiness and justice, right relationship with God for all peoples, and right relationships between and among peoples. Is that happening? Are we doing it? Do we have this same boldness, this same courage that Jesus had in doing his thing? See, this is the thing, right? He's doing what he's sent to do. And he faces down opposition as it relates to them opposing him as he's doing what he's supposed to be doing, as like living out his vocation. Are we doing what we're supposed to be doing? Are we advancing God's purposes everywhere we can, wherever we are? Are we living out the mercy of God, right? Have we received the mercy of God for ourselves? We turned our lives over to God and found that he loves us, even in spite of everything that we could have done to offend against him and his purposes. He loves us, and he's claiming us for his reign, for his kingdom. He wants us to live under his loving rule and so find freedom for ourselves, and he wants us to help advance his loving rule by the power of his Spirit. Are we doing that, right? Are we looking to bring holiness to bear in the world? Are we looking to help restore people to right relationship with God? That sounds wild, doesn't it? Does that sound too, I don't know if I said it right, it doesn't sound wild, but is it, that sound crazy? Like, that's a lot to do. How do we help restore people to right relationship with God? I think, first of all, we listen to them. Right, we see how their hearts are crying out for God, even though they may not even put words to it like that. But we know that every human being is made for God, and that every human being, every heart is yearning for God. Right, and what are we doing to help people find him? I mean, we have his Holy Spirit at work in us and working through us. Surely we have something to offer people, the world that's searching for God. And they are. And the worse things get, the more people thirst. The worse things get, the more people thirst. So where are we offering God, offering living water that Jesus has given to us, is pouring out into us and through us? And then, of course, justice. We have to be on the lookout for ways that we can go after injustice and speak truth with boldness. In fact, sometimes just show up. Sometimes just showing up and standing in the face of injustice does the trick. So where are we being called? We're God's missioned people. We're made to be Jesus' own body. Where are we showing up? And how are we helping to bring about his kingdom? The rest doesn't matter at all. The fact that we're going to face opposition, or that we might face opposition, doesn't matter at all. Because we have Jesus' own Spirit at work in us and working through us. We ought not have fear at all, because we're so saturated with love that we really could care less what happens as a result of our bringing it to bear in the world.